The town may be kind of small, but these folks have big smiles and big hearts. And they know what it is to have simple fun down our way. Where old-fashioned singing and homey gatherings make living mighty pleasant.
It's very hard for me to listen to Spotify with musics that I know during intimate moments because I will get sidetracked by the music. And my girlfriend's like, what's wrong? I'm like, can we listen to something else? Because I'm listening to the lyrics and, you know, and she's like, really? Yeah. Sorry about that.
If your lady wants quality nookie time, she better put something unfamiliar on.
Yeah. Look how halfway singing is.
Hey, Troy.
Welcome to Abandoned Albums, the documentary podcast where we take a closer look at some albums that may have been forgotten about over time, some albums you might not even know existed, and some albums by up-and-coming artists we think you should know about. I'm your host, Keith R. Higgins, and joining me, as always, is Mr. Jeff Calhoun.
Throwing an enthusiastic La Mano Cornuda. You know that one? The Horned Hand.
I'm familiar with that. I didn't
made famous by Ronnie James Dio.
I didn't realize that was the name.
La Mano Cornuda.
On this episode of Abandoned Albums, Keith and Jeff welcome Jeremy Chatelain into Thunderlove Studio.
The paper doesn't give many details. Tell me about this.
Might know him from Jets to Brazil as the bass player, but you might know him from Handsome as the vocalist. I mean, usually you play guitar and sing and you're like both, right? But he was the bass player and sang backup with Blake Schwarzenbach in Jets to Brazil. But he was the vocalist. Like, that was his role in this band, Handsome. He's played in the band Helmet. He's got an alt country project called Cub Country that's pretty wonderful. So a wide spectrum of styles. But for my money, I think that the one album that he did, and it does kind of fit the name of the podcast. I think it's an abandoned album in that he made a record with this, with what a lot of people call a superstar, an all-star lineup. Jeremy, in that one album and that one moment, delivers a truly exceptional and memorable vocal performance. And it's everything, man. It's the poetry and the words and the sentiment and the power of the performance. It's a record that has always struck me as superior in a lot of ways to the, because that genre of, boy, I'm gonna get some emails on this one. It was very heavily palm muted, jug rock and roll, and I don't. There are probably better ways to describe it, but this record with Handsome just, it does something for me that a lot of its peers do not. It's interesting in ways that its peers fail to be. It seems like a record that maybe missed its moment. Like, I know that there were. That the band didn't get along all that great. There were a lot of bands trying to sound like that. It's just a really, really fucking awesome band and record. And I'm so eager to talk to this dude. Man, I can't believe he agreed to come on the show. So I'm full stoke. I'm 10 out of 10. Let's rock and roll. Here is our conversation with Jeremy Chatelain of Handsome.
Well, thank you. Thank you for joining us. This is, Jeff turned me on to Handsome, and I was just, I'll be honest, I was a little gobsmacked.
Oh.
It's right in my hard rock wheelhouse, you know? So thank you, Jeff, and thank you, Jeremy.
Yeah. 90s post-hardcore.
Let's start there, because I want to back up in your career. I want to set the tone for Handsome. I think we do ourselves a disservice if we don't talk about Jets to Brazil and Helmet and Cub Country and your other music, because you've had a prolific career. But that Handsome record, it does something for me, something unique and special. But in Salt Lake City, you started your musical career. Was Iceburn first, or was Insight the first band that you had?
Insight was the first band that I was in around here that did anything that sort of made a mark. I discovered, you know, hardcore punk when I was a teenager, because I lived in a really kind of boring suburb, you know, that was really sort of whitewashed and not a lot going on. I grew up Mormon, as a lot of people here do. And I wanted the extreme nature of like gnarly hardcore. The first records I had were like Agnostic Front, the Angry Samoans, Sex Pistols, Government Issue, the Misfits, like all those kind of records. I loved it. Crass, I was into Crass. So I started going to hardcore shows, and then I was like, oh, I want to play guitar and I want to be in a band. And I gave up skateboarding and all my other hobbies. We started doing a couple bands around here, a band called Past Tense, which didn't do a whole lot, but we played some cool shows. And then like sort of out of the ashes of that, we formed Insight. And like a lot of bands that came out of that mid 80s hardcore scene, we saw, do you know who Youth of Today are?
Sure.
So we saw Youth of Today on the Breakdown the Walls tour, and my mind was blown. And then we were like, oh, we need to do like a fast, like aggressive hardcore band. We just went down that road. Those were the first kind of like tours I did across the country. First time I ever like actually traveled east of Wyoming. And we went all the way across the states. Got home. We were not getting along, as you know, 17 and 18 year olds do after 3 years. And some of us were sort of college bound and things like that, and started getting into, you know, our musical tastes started to expand, which is what happens with all of us. People started listening to jazz, and gosh, I went down a classic rock road, like hardcore. And we started Iceburn sort of out of the ashes of Insight. And our singer, the singer of Mark from Insight, he moved to Los Angeles to go pursue music and do other things and get out of here. And we did Iceburn. I was only in Iceburn for about 10 months or so, enough to do we did a single on Victory Records. It was like, it came out on like a clear vinyl 7-inch and a single. I thought it was so cool. I love the rap on the single. I was like, this is awesome.
I don't see that medium making a comeback.
The single seems like a waste of time.
It sure does.
It seems to, yeah, it fails cost benefit analysis.
Yeah, my I liked, like, I'm a critic of the way things sound, and I think cassettes are like a terrible medium. Oh my God, I'm going to sound so old when I say this, but I think there's a label that's going to put out an Insight retrospective on a cassette, and it's coming out soon.
You look marvelous. You really do. No, applause is fabulous, you know, but you covered the Olympics, you covered all of those things. My favorite thing, Howard. May I call you Howard?
Of course.
My favorite thing, look, the Battle of the Network Stars to me is the epitome of sports at this, but I think it is the most marvelous. Of course, you got all these beautiful women and these guys, and together they look marvelous.
Handsome has been described as a supergroup, and I don't know if you have any feelings about that term or not. Each respective member's resume was impressive. I've never gotten the impression that it was you as the original orchestrator. I felt like you were somebody that Pete or Tom were like, hey, we want you to join this group as we're forming it. Talk me through how the group came together originally.
Okay. Yeah, that's interesting. I was going to say supergroup due to everybody else's resume and not mine. I quit Iceburn. I got really burnt out on college here in Salt Lake. And do you know the band Into Another?
I don't.
I do not, no.
There are a couple guys from the New York hardcore scene who formed another band with these two dudes who were like really good players, a bass player and a guitar player, Peter and Tony. And they did this band that sounds like, it's like glam metal. It's like David Bowie meets Black Sabbath meets Prague. Anyway, I was in love with it. And it came out on Revelation, which was a hardcore label. And the singer was a buddy of mine, like a pen pal, Richie. And I asked them if they would take me on tour because I was tired of being in Salt Lake. And he said, yeah. So I ended up going on tour with them for like 3 months. And during the course of the tour, he was like, oh, I've got a new girlfriend. I'm moving in with this girlfriend. And I'm giving up my apartment in New York City. And I was like, oh, the light bulb went off. I was like, I'm going to move to New York City. Got back to Salt Lake, worked a job for the summer, and then packed up my stuff. And actually, Richie flew out here, and then he and I drove back to New York. And I swear I was in New York for like 3 weeks. And I caught wind of, oh, there's a new band with Pete Hines. I was a total Cro-Mags fan. And they were like, there's this new band with that Pete Hines is the drummer for. And it's called Handsome. And I was like, oh, that name is awesome. Cause I'm a Smiths nerd to the max. And they, you know, they said, oh, he's doing the band with Peter that was in Helmet. And I, you know, my old bandmates were like just in love with Helmet. And so of course I knew who they were. Well, I went to a party, like a Christmas party, and I ran into Pete and Arthur. So Arthur is the bass player of Gorilla Biscuits. He was in Handsome at the time, and they were like, oh, we have this band called Handsome. And I was like, I've heard of you. Pete Hines was like, we have this singer guy. We don't like him. We need a new singer. And I was like, oh, that's funny. I sing. They were like, do you want to come audition? And I was like, sure. This was very casual in someone's apartment. Peter Mengede actually ended up calling me. They got my phone number back before cell phones. It was like my actual, he called me, do you want to meet and we can go out and have coffee or whatever. And I think they just wanted to like size me up and see what was going on. And I think I gave them a single of the Iceburn recordings, and they invited me down to a rehearsal. Their manager was there. We rehearsed in this like really shitty room in Long Island City, New York. And, you know, I had just come from Utah. I'm just going to hang out over here in the corner and listen to like what you guys are doing. And they were sort of like, no, you're not. You're going to stand up and you're going to sing into that microphone. And I was like, oh shit. So I did it, you know, got up, and we just kept doing that. Like we started doing it regularly. Like let's do this again. And I started writing lyrics, and I think they had multiple singers in the band. The dude who was in the band before me was sort of like Stone Temple Pilots-y, like Scott Weiland a little bit, that kind of vibe. And I think they were looking for, I'm not sure what they were looking for, but they accepted me into their band. Arthur left to go do the band Civ. And then Eddie, who was the original bass player, came back to the band. And just like a brutally good bass player. And it sort of like sealed the deal. So it was the four of us for a while, me, Eddie, Pete, and Peter. And we immediately started playing shows out of town, going to like Rhode Island, Boston, Jersey, and doing sort of shows at smaller clubs. Nobody knew who we were. And it wasn't billed as a super group at that point. It was sort of like, I think, yeah, we were playing shows with like local bands in places around there, and we played CBGBs, and yeah, just did that kind of thing for a little bit.
When you go audition and you're meeting these guys to jam for the first time, what's the first song you play? I mean, is it something that you all know? Is it something like, I don't know, Dirty Water or Johnny Be Good? Or
no, was not. We were playing their songs.
Oh, okay.
They had a million songs. That was one of the things that I was impressed with, because growing up, I was in bands, like hardcore bands would have like 15 songs total. And you could play them all in like 7 minutes. and this was like, these guys had like, they played their songs. And so I stood up and I was just improvising words and trying to like find kind of like, you know, trying to find some kind of key to sing in, and like, yeah, it was intimidating. And I felt extremely awkward, you know, and I was like, oh, I'm not, when it was over, I was like, I'm not sure how that went at all, you know, and they dropped me off at my apartment and I was like, see you never. But they called me back. Well, basically they were like, write words to these two songs. And they gave me a, like a cassette, so many cassettes getting passed back and forth. Yeah, it was very weird. But it seems like more, you know, I always hear that story of like John Paul Jones going to like Led Zeppelin practice, and they were like, we'll just play these blues standards, and they all knew him. And he's like, oh, it was amazing. You know? And I was like, that handsome audition was not amazing like that.
Here in Birmingham, where I'm from, there is a really terrific festival called Furnace Fest that is built around hardcore.
Oh yeah.
And 10 minutes ago you referenced Handsome as a New York City hardcore band. And I think that's something I've picked up on attending Furnace Fest and realizing the breadth of this hardcore scene. I'm wondering if you can help me understand what makes New York City hardcore stand apart from the rest of the scene. I think there's something unique about that.
I had an obsession with bands from New York when I was young. I was a 7-inch collector and a 12-inch, you know, I collected records, first presses, and I had to get all of it. I was obsessed with it. But like the records that were coming out of New York on Revelation and, you know, like the Cro-Mags records, all those records, Youth of Today, Underdog, all these bands, they were just my favorites. New York hardcore was this like brutal, angry, short, fast bursts of energy that were just like, they were so, it was like foreign to my life. And it was like totally what I needed. We would see videos of the shows happening in New York City, and there were 1,000 people at a hardcore show. I couldn't imagine that. And it was like, it was just brutal. It was kind of a, like the music sounded like kind of tough. I think Sammy from Judge, he called it caveman shit. It was just like four chords, brutal, like the beginnings of hardcore, Agnostic Front, you know, like that kind of thing, where it's like the people aren't necessarily players, but it's like rhythmic music instead of melodic music. It's rhythmic and it's brutal and it's loud, short, fast, and just like a burst, you know, and something you can just jump around and say fuck to, you know?
Yeah.
but I looked to New York City because it was so far removed from what I grew up with. So when I got out there and then I actually wound up playing with a few guys who were in bands, you know, I was like a pig in shit. I was so happy. I don't know if that explains it, but there's like, yeah, the New York hardcore thing had like a, there was definitely this like brutal sound to it that was like,
I just think there's a pulse and an energy to the city. And I think that probably translates into the music, regardless of genre.
Undeniably, I think that's the case. Have you ever seen the Basquiat movie, Downtown 81?
I remember seeing it a long time ago. Yeah, yeah.
So it's a weird art film, and they lost the audio to it, but it's basically Basquiat wandering around the East Village in New York and like hawking paintings, and he goes to the Mud Club and plays with his band and like runs into, you know, it's like the No Wave scene that happened there.
Yeah, yeah.
Even that holds some magical place for me, but the city looks like a war zone. Buildings have fallen down and he's walking by them, and it was just instead of being repelled by it, I was attracted to it. I was like, well, I want to go there. And so did everybody else that I was here, you know, like that was here with me in Utah. I wanted to like I don't think it's coincidence that like artists of all kinds are drawn to that, to New York City. It's like, there's a reason. It's magnetic for sure.
I first went there in 1982, went to the city, and there was just something. I was like, I just felt at home. I think it was the energy that I fed off of it, certainly. It's so great. That's why they named it twice.
That's right. That's right. I found it fascinating that there were like, that there were kids who were my age, who are 18 years old, doing hardcore bands in the city. I was like, where do you practice? Like, how do you get to the show? We played at ABC No Rio, which was down on the Lower East Side in 1989, I think. And it was like, I sat in the van all day. I was really freaked out to go walk around the neighborhood. And we got in there. I think we played with Super Touch. It was quite a day.
I have seen interviews with you, Jeremy, where you talk about the connection between that opening track on the album, Needles, and the city, and New York City, and that they're pretty closely connected. Tell me what you remember about Needles and that connection.
That was probably one of the first, like the first sets of lyrics that I wrote for the band. And it was interesting because they were, the songs were like finished. They were done. You know, they're like, here's the arrangement of the song. And I would go with my notepad and go write down. And I was like, really, I was a definitely like, I wrote a lot. I had, you know, I would keep journals and books of poetry and things like that. And I do remember putting together sort of couplets of like how I felt about the city. And I wanted the Handsome record to reflect, like, I just wanted it to be 100% New York. I wanted it to feel like that, sound like that. We wanted the cover to look like that. And there was no, like, I think we were all pretty unified about that. It was interesting too, like right after moving to New York, the title of Needles is probably a reference. It was the first time I'd ever met anyone who was like a junkie. It was a thing in New York. And, you know, when I started working in like the downtown restaurant scene and stuff like that, I was like, oh, this is a prevalent thing. And in the music and art scene, it was fairly common that people had like done that. And once again, for some reason, I was like, whoa, tell me more. Not repelled by it, but I was like, I had a fascination with it, but it wasn't like, I didn't dabble or anything like that. I was like, I think at that point in my life, I was very, very straight edge.
Yeah.
But yeah, the words are sort of about, you know, I'm thinking of the couplets now, like dogs of the mirrored glass in the filthy city, they lick and lap at your face. I talked about like, I think the guy who made the video tried to capture, did you ever see the video?
Yes, it's very New York.
Yeah. It was just sort of how I felt, like, you know, the city like wanted you to get into that, to the wheel that was always spinning. And I was kind of like resisting at first, like trying to stay on the outside of that thing. And then I was like, I guess I have to dive in to be, you know, I lived there for 10 years. Yeah. You have to give in, I think, to accept the energy of the city rather than resist it.
Yes.
I think it's that way with any city, but New York is intense.
The once great city of New York becomes the one maximum security prison for the entire country. A 50-foot containment wall is erected along the New Jersey shoreline, across the Harlem River, and down along the Brooklyn shoreline. The rules are simple. Once you go in, you don't come out.
My friend, so pre-cell phones, he's like giving me directions. He's like, come over to my apartment and we'll play music. Great. And he's like, when you get out of the train station, hop up, find a payphone and call me, and then I'll tell you where I live from there. I came up out of the train station. I swear to God, there was a car up on blocks. Someone had stolen the tires. There was a fucking pack of dogs. And there was something on fire in the street. And I was like, I ran to this phone and I was like, there, you know, there was no place I could go. I came up out of the train and I was like, nobody was on the street. And he was like, great, you made it. I was like, I made it.
A lot of people made assumptions about this band. And I think that Dim the Lights was the song that to me was like the perfect marriage of all the harmony with the intensity of the hardcore influences coming together in a really harmonious way.
It's interesting because I think Eddie's vision for the band, you know, he was like a huge Beatles fan. And at some point when we were traveling a lot, we were all, the Beatles was, it was like our regular soundtrack, you know, it was like we were listening to Rubber Soul and Revolver over and over again. And he said, I want this to be brutal, but I want there to be like the brutalness of the Bad Brains, but like the melody of the Beatles. Not only did I love hardcore, I also loved pop music and like Britpop music and, you know, 80s. Like I was into all the 80s bands, Duran Duran, Echo and the Bunnymen, like all of that stuff. And I love melody, you know, it's like, that's what makes a lot of songs for me. But, and it's interesting you say that because it's funny, like I used to read the reviews of the record after it came out and people had big beef with, I think with me in particular, thinking that I had like wrecked this, I had wrecked really? This hardcore band. You know what I mean? And I think
you were too melodic.
I think that they were just like, what is this guy's voice? Like, you know, there were all kinds of, I've seen videos that we have online on YouTube. There's lots of, you know, there's lots of armchair critics.
Sure.
It is what it is. I made a concerted effort not to be, I was not a hardcore singer. I was like a singer. I wanted to sing and write lyrics that were interesting, you know, and people felt like they could relate to. I'm not like a yeller. I'm not like a throaty, you know, like, ugh. I'm not a brutal singer. That's just not my thing. And I think some people felt like it ruined the band.
You didn't shout enough for their liking?
Well, I think some of the, it's interesting because I think some of that got into my bandmates' head. During the making of the Handsome record, they kept pulling people in to try and coach me and give me pep talks. And I was 24 years old. And I think my attitude was like, fuck you. You hired me to do the thing that I do and I'm going to do it. Which is interesting because I was in the band with all these hard ass people that were like, you know, dude, you got to do this. You got to do that. And I was like, fuck you. If you want to find a different singer, you can find a different singer. Like, this is what I do. And then in the end, they were like, oh, I think we made the right choice. You know, I was like, okay. Yeah. But it certainly didn't do a lot for my ego when there was doubt about what I was doing, especially in the studio. And, you know, the band had been signed by Michael Goldstone was our A&R guy at Epic.
Goldie. Which another, like, another Goldie connection.
Yeah, which is like a huge, you know, it was huge. Me coming from Utah, coming out to New York City, joining a band, within a year we got signed to Epic Records by Michael Goldstone, who, you know, did Shudder to Think, Rage Against the Machine, Pearl Jam, shit. He worked with Ozzy, the Screaming Trees, all these people. Goldie would come and pick me up from the studio and give me pep talks. He took me to a barbecue at I can't remember the manager of Pearl Jam's name. Kelly Curtis.
Yep.
He took me to a barbecue at his house and like Stone Gossard was making me veggie burgers. It was the funniest shit. He was like asking me about Handsome, you know, and I was feeling, wow, this experience. I'm recording at Bad Animals, which is this studio in Seattle.
Yeah.
That the women from Heart at the time owned.
Yeah.
I think I met Ann Wilson at one point in the lobby and I was freaking out.
Yep.
REM had just recorded there before we did. They left we found some of their shit in like a drawer. I was like, oh, I think this is REM stuff.
wow.
That kind of thing where I was like, this is a dream come true. And then also creative wrestling with the bandmates also made it like a nightmare. And so I was like pulled, you know, I was pulled, which may be where some of the like sort of tension in the record comes from. It was a really interesting dichotomy, but Stone Gossard was asking me about the band. How's it going? You know, I was like, it's going okay. And, he's like, what kind of music do you play? And I was like, it's like heavy post rock. And he was like, it's like, chin, 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 like put your foot on the monitor. Like, chin, chin, chin. I was like, yes, that's what it is. It's that. What an interesting time.
Absolutely.
The band certainly had tensions. The five of us, Tom was asked to join the band when Quicksand broke up for the, maybe it was the second time or something. We were at a rehearsal and Peter was like, I think we should ask Tom to come and play. And Tom's just like a cool dude, tastemaker, great guitar player, very innovative, was into interesting things. But the five of our personalities together were like oil and water.
Wow.
And you seem to know it even then. I saw a video where the five of you were being interviewed. I think it was on tour. And you came out and said,
the dynamic of the band is really odd. A lot of people say that's what makes it special because we have a hard time getting along a lot of times. And it's good. Musically, it's a good vibe.
Yeah, yeah, it was true. I think any one of us would have told you that. Our manager used to always show up. He's like, you know, come on, you guys, you got to pull it together because this could be as great as The Who. Look at, you know, and The Who were like also a band that I grew up with that are very dear to my heart. And he was like, you know, they like punched each other out and they still got up on stage and played. And I was like, I just don't envision that. To me, a band was like, it was a creative endeavor. I have a lot of creative energy and I wanted to like be able to express myself and like get my creative energy out there and make music. Like that's been my passion. I have a singular passion in this life and it's music. And my wife thinks I'm a freak for it, but we didn't get along very well. We had our moments where like, I would describe it as, it was a really powerful unit. And when it worked, I think it was probably a great thing to like see and hear, you know, when everyone went out on stage, the five of us, and we were confident and we felt like everybody's got each other's backs. It was probably like, oh, this is great. Good night. And then there were nights where it was just like just a nightmare and just feeling like, ugh, I don't want to have anything to do with this right now.
Wow.
Yeah. Interesting way to feel when you're trying to make art together.
Yeah.
Not the easiest.
Alternative radio started to shape, especially in the late 90s. Alternative radio really had a big influence on where the scene went. And that space that maybe Helmet and Quicksand were, and a lot of the hardcore contemporaries were unique in, that space started to get much more crowded. Listening back to this record, I feel like it stands head and shoulders above all of its peers. And I would include some of the Helmet catalog and the Quicksand catalog with that. I really do think it's one of the best records of the genre and unique. I don't think that there is another band exactly like Handsome.
I get warm, fuzzy feelings when you say that. I get like people reach out to me via social media or whatever way still, and they have deep feelings about the Handsome record. Don't get me wrong, for all the time we spent not getting along, we also busted our asses and rehearsed like 5 times a week for hours at a time, just loud as fuck and just going for it, you know? And we put a lot of energy and effort into the songs. I don't think anyone in the band was like, I don't give a fuck, you know? I think the problem was is that everybody cared a lot and had a slightly different vision of how this puzzle was supposed to fit together, and the personalities clashed.
Yeah.
For me, I was young, and I also think, like, just looking back, I was, what the hell, like, what goes through your head as a 24-year-old with this huge opportunity in front of you? I mean, I guess it happened for, you know, some people. They could gather all their shit together into one basket and really make successful choices with something like this. That was not the case for me. I felt confusion, and like I was torn, you know. Some weeks I was like, I hate this, and other weeks I was like, I can't believe I'm doing this. It's like, it's the best.
Yeah,
it was like whiplash. I felt like, I'm so confused. And I'm sure my bandmates felt it. I remember there being rehearsals where we were there and things got heated and people would quit and walk out. Fuck you, I'm quitting. I hate this band. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then you rehearse again the next day.
Yeah. Thrown Away is a song that, to me, for every fan of Helmet and Quicksand and Deftones and all those, you know, drop D tuned, super heavy guitars, whatever expectations people put on Handsome, that's the song that realized those expectations. One of the most successful vocal performances for you on the whole record, I think.
That's interesting.
I think Thrown Away is a song that feels like someone has knocked me over and is standing over me, punching me in the face repeatedly.
Yeah.
the guitar tones that Terry Date and Peter and Tom achieved on the record were just like, I remember when they were recording, you know, we went in to go listen to Ruffs every day. And when they first like stacked all those guitars up, we were like, oh shit, this is a thing. I remember Super Unknown came out around that time, the Soundgarden record, and Super Unknown sounds like it's played in a massive room. Well, our record was played in a massive room, but with blankets over it. Everything had blankets over it. It was crazy. But it has that, like, if you listen to it in headphones, it sounds like we're right next to you.
I consider it a headphone record, by the way.
I like that. I love that there's people who are still into the record. I love that it stands up. It, you know, it might even be more important to me that way than had it had some kind of like larger success and been just a flash in the pan. You know what I mean? There were a lot of cheesy hard rock records that came out around that time too.
Yes, there were.
All of us were really cognizant about like trying to avoid the cheese factor and like, here's where other bands are headed and here's where Handsome is headed, you know? And like, we were trying to make the most out of the five pieces, and Thrown Away was just like a pissed off riff, but it has like a kind of a melodic chorus, which is what Peter and Eddie were just brilliant at writing these things that were just brutal riffs. The lyric is most likely a reflection of growing up in a repressed atmosphere, like, you know, like Salt Lake City in the 80s and late 70s, and wanting to burst out and do something else, you know, just ditch it all. I'm trying to think of the chorus. Why am I spacing on it right now?
I think Jeff might have it there.
We are built upon fraught foundation, and we are built around misplaced expectation.
All right. I'll tell you, this is 100% based on folks who grew up feeling suffocated by their surroundings. I think everybody could relate.
For sure.
I wanted it to have a kind of punk rock energy, be melodic, but you could tell that it's like, that it's pissed off, you know?
The guitar interplay makes no doubt about that.
Yeah.
It's, whew, that song announces itself in such a bold way.
Yeah, it just comes right out of the box. Stomping is what we used to say.
Absolutely.
And let's have a little mountain first. Maybe we'll do a couple mountains. We'll have one that lives far away. This little mountain, he lives wee back here, almost to the edge of nowhere.
Ken Schless and the artwork and the look of the record.
Ken was super rad. He was chosen on purpose because he is a biographer of the underbelly of New York City. When you're signed to a major label, you have like an art director there who has, you know, they have access to all kinds of things and they present you with choices. I think they brought some of Ken's work in, and all of us were just like, oh, he's the guy. Yeah. And Ken was really sweet. He and his assistant and me, when we were at Bad Animals, he was like, I think everyone who was around me could sense my sort of like misery at times. And he was like, hey, you should come on a drive and we'll go location scouting for band photos. Yeah. Ken was cool. He ended up doing the video too.
Oh, nice. I didn't realize that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah. He shot the video. Nice. We shot the video in the basement of this school. It was in the East Village. It was an abandoned school, and we shot in the basement. I'm assuming it's not even there anymore, and the basement had like water in it. It was nasty. But like it was the perfect setting for what we were going for.
Bits and pieces that come out of the retelling of the Handsome story make me wish for more. Like when I hear that you went into the studio with 19 songs, there's a part of my brain that's like, well, what, there's got to be more. There's got, like, somebody has a cassette somewhere of some demos. You know, maybe Jeremy and Tom and Pete and the crew will get back together and do a 2023, a new version of it. Like, I've always craved more from that lineup.
We recorded a single with Keith Cleversley, who made the Hum record in Chicago when we were on tour with the Deftones. That's floating around somewhere. It's got two songs on it that didn't make the record. We made like a 19 song demo, and a couple of years ago, is that label 6131? Is that what they're called? It is, right? The one that repressed the Handsome record on vinyl.
Mm-hmm.
That guy, Sean, he got a hold of me and we started talking about the repress. And I was like, I think literally my words were, good luck getting a hold of the Handsome record. It is locked in that monolithic Sony building in New York City. Best of luck to you. You know, he emailed me a few months later, like, oh, we're going to repress the record. I was like, amazing.
Wow.
You're a miracle. Wow. He was hot on doing another release that there's two 7-inches, the Sub Pop 7-inch, and then there's the Waiting 7-inch. He was going to do those. And then we were talking about like sort of skimming through the, you know, having the cassette tape remastered or something. We recorded the cassette, the 19 song demo, once again, cassette, at this studio called Loho down on Spring Street. And we started listening through to it. And I think we all just sort of shot the idea down. Not Sean, but Peter and I. Peter is, God bless him, he is protective of the legacy. Preserving the legacy of Handsome as it is, not spoiling it, and not opening any new can of worms. So I think that for the time being, the hidden songs are going to stay hidden. And do you have the CD version that has the two other songs on it?
I don't think I do.
Shit, I'm trying to remember what they're called.
They're called Spill and Closer. Spill. Is that it?
Closer? Spill and Closer. Yes.
There you go.
Yep.
So those were recorded with Terry. And then we also have a version of Swimming. It's funny because the version of Swimming that's on the Handsome record is a reworking of the Sub Pop 7-inch version. We didn't re-record it, but we did record it with Terry. I liked the one we recorded with Terry because I thought it was more like succinct and tight. But we ended up using the Sub Pop 7-inch because Michael Goldstone was like a big fan of that. He was like, that's what made me love your band. And I want to put that version of that song on the record.
Cool.
Do you know the author John Cheever?
Yeah, of course.
So he writes all these amazing short stories. There's a short story called The Swimmer. And that's what that song is based on. That Swimming is based on that. I was a fan right out of college of the short stories, and we studied The Swimmer. The song pretty much follows the story of the guy. Swimming was one of those songs that was written after I had joined the band. Peter described it as like, we've got this, you know, this soaring bass and guitar riff that comes in and it goes into this like beautiful, huge melodic chorus. And I was like, I was excited to write some words to it. Yeah, it was fun how it came together. We were pretty pumped on it, but I don't know how I got off on that. Anyway, there's a Terry Date version of that song that was never released. We also recorded a radio edit of Dim the Lights. If you go on to Bandcamp, I have a page called Bootleg Series.
Okay.
And I think the radio edit version of Dim the Lights is on there.
Nice.
And it's different than the album version. See, I'm trying to sneak a couple of like...
I love it.
I'm trying to sneak a couple out there.
Yes. We won't tell Peter.
You can tell Peter.
And now for something completely different.
It's interesting to me, the pivot. To my knowledge, you were a vocalist only in Handsome. You never picked up any kind of instrument in that group.
For 5 seconds, I played guitar. Peter was like, you're a good guitar player. You should play guitar in the band. And I was like, I don't want to do that. All the hardcore singers that I liked, they didn't play guitar and sing. They just had the mic.
So to go from that experience to now you're playing bass with Blake, you know, so Blake Schwarzenbach, Jets Brazil is, help me out with the timeline. How much time passed between the end of Handsome and you picked up with Blake as like the next thing you wanted to do?
Let's see. When we were recording the Handsome record, Jawbreaker, I started hearing about Jawbreaker everywhere, like mostly from like industry types that were around us. Like, have you heard about Jawbreaker? Have you heard about Jawbreaker? I was like, oh my God, yes, I've heard about Jawbreaker. Like, leave me alone. And my girlfriend at the time, who I'm married to now, she lived in Brooklyn with this woman who was dating Blake. And they knew each other from LA or San Francisco. And she was like, oh, while we were recording the Handsome record in Seattle, she was like, Jawbreaker's playing at the Crocodile. I'll get Blake to put you on the list. And I was like, Blake would put me on the list. He doesn't know me. She was like, oh, he's really nice. He'll throw you on the list. So I went by myself. I ended up talking to him after the show. He was one show away from from quitting Jawbreaker, which, you know, people didn't know at the time, but I could tell. I remember I was wearing like a Vespa scooter pin on my jacket and he was like, cool pin. And then he was immediately like, you know, there were 10,000 people trying to talk to him. And I was like, see you later, you know, cause I was just like, I know Amra. And the next night in, I don't know, Bellingham or something, he quit the band and that was the end of Jawbreaker. Blake moved from the West Coast to the East Coast and he moved not far from where I was living at the time. He just lived on the other side of Prospect Park. They were like, oh, we're going to go get, you know, my wife, Catherine and Amra were like, we're going to go get tacos and Blake is coming. And I was like, cool. Is that the guy from Jawbreaker? And they were like, yeah. And I was like, well, I need to go sneaker shopping too. So we could make a day of it. And then we went out and got tacos and we were like chatting. And I was like, oh man, he's really nice. He's uber smart, you know, good conversationalist, can be awkward, like all the things I like in human beings. We ended up clicking. And then like after like a year, maybe a little more than a year of touring with Handsome, the bottom kind of started to fall out of the band. We were in Europe. Let's see, Tom quit to go back to Quicksand. And we got this guy, Donnie, to fill in on second guitar. Donnie went on tour to like Europe and did the last US tour with us. Goldstone quit Epic and went to go start DreamWorks with fucking Jeff Bezos. I don't know.
There was a lot of money behind DreamWorks. There's a lot of money.
It wasn't Bezos, but yeah, there was a lot of money there. Yeah.
I just remember hearing about the, like, you know, the godhead of like music industry types starting this label thing, DreamWorks. And I was like, Jesus Christ, he was gone. And that like totally deflated us. Cause he was our champion. You know, we got assigned to this other A&R team. They were fine. They were nice. They weren't Michael Goldstone to us. And then our manager was like, hey, Epic is putting a freeze on your salaries. This is great. Some great major label shit. They're putting a freeze on your salaries until you come home, because you're out here spending money on the road on buses and hotel rooms, until you come home and write a new record. We got home from Europe and I came back to Utah just to visit my family. And I was like, fuck that. I'm not doing that. I had been having a hell of a time and I was like trying to envision myself getting into a creative space with all the dudes I don't know. We couldn't, I don't, there was like some arguments in the rehearsal room and I was like, I'm not going to do this. And Peter was like, it's time to get back to work. And I was like, I'm not doing that. And he was like, hold off. You know, there's a lot at stake here. And I was like, I completely understand. And I'm not going to do that. I can't envision myself like trying to get into the headspace of getting creative with that group of people again and going through it all again.
Dude, that takes serious balls to audition and then to leave the band. Big ups to you. That's some serious balls, man.
Well, it's either that or I'm just a fucking dumbass, you know? Some people would be like, oh my God, you blew it. But it was like doing the thing that you always dream of doing, getting paid for that thing, which sort of compromises the thing also. And then the whole situation, you know, surrounding the thing, which is like the creative situation and trying to make a piece of art together, turned out to be not just difficult, because I can handle difficult, but it turned out to be dark. It was like, It was dark, and it was like a real like ego fuck for me. I was like, oh, I suck all the time, you know, like, oh my God, I'm terrible, you know? And then I would be like, I'm doing okay. And I was just like, I don't want to do that again. Literally a week later, we were walking around Brooklyn or whatever. And I was talking to Catherine, and I was like, I think I'm going to call Blake and see what he's doing. just a random conversation. I called him and he was like, oh, I've been writing songs. I've got this rehearsal space over in Williamsburg. We used to rehearse right off the Williamsburg Bridge in this cool old building. I've got this rehearsal space. You should come over. I'm just making songs with a drum machine. I went over there and I had felt kind of like stunted, you know, creatively. I had hit a wall, not sure what I was doing. I went over and Blake had this like just this notebook full of songs. And he was playing me these like four track demos he made. And then he was like, it was very brave. He was just like, check this out. And he would put the drum machine on and they would start playing songs and singing them to me. And I was like, oh my God, dude, how many songs do you have? And I remember we literally had the conversation. He was like, do you play guitar? Do you play bass? Like, what do you play? I was like, I have a bass. I could bring it over and I could play with the drum machine too. And we started doing that casually, and after like a few weeks of it, he was sort of like, we should find a drummer. And I was like, oh wow, does this mean we're gonna do a band? I had like gotten a job again and I was working at a restaurant in New York, and yeah, so we started playing, and then we started auditioning drummers, and we had all these great tunes, and it was really fun writing bass lines, like melodic bass lines all over the stuff. And the songs were like a left turn from what I had been doing. And I was like, oh, this is sort of scratching an itch I have right now. So we tried out several drummers. We tried out Zach from Jawbox, and we tried out Chris, who eventually ended up being our drummer. And I just remember Blake going, well, what do you think? You think we should ask Chris Daly to play? I was just reading Chris's story of this whole situation too, because I think he had not heard from us for a few weeks, and he was like, I don't want to do that anyway. and then as soon as he made up his mind, he was sort of like, well, wait, I kind of like those songs, because we had all these, like, they were songs, they were like really good songs.
Yes.
It wasn't just ideas, it was like we were prepping for something. And we asked Chris to do it, and he was like, yeah, I think I could do that. And then we started playing as a three-piece, hammering out a bunch of songs. And then we asked Pete Martin, who was the guitar player in a band called Lifetime, to play second guitar. We started playing shows like pretty quickly, within a year of Blake and I meeting up. I think we were playing shows, played with Modest Mouse, and started to sort of get attention from folks around the city. And Chris was connected because he had just come out of Texas Is the Reason. You know, it was like Chris came out of Texas Is the Reason. I came out of Handsome. Blake came out of Jawbreaker. So it was another sort of like super emo super group.
I wasn't going to go there.
I went there for you.
Thank you.
And then Pete joined, and then Chris had all these connections from Texas because they were, you know, Texas is the reason was super popular in the sort of indie rock underground at the time. And he knew the Jade Tree guys, and they had approached us. And then we ended up going on a summer tour before we had a record out or anything. We made a demo in New Jersey with this guy named Alop, who was in a band called Dalek. They're like a hip hop group from New Jersey. But Alop had this studio in his basement out in Jersey, and we went out there and recorded this demo. We were just stoked to get the songs like cemented together. Did that. We ended up going out for 3 weeks to Europe with the Promise Ring just to like road test our songs. And it was so much damn fun. Oh my God. And it was like, yeah, it was like a whole different ball of wax from what I had just come from.
Yeah.
I'm trying not to disparage the handsome situation because I feel like I'm very proud of that record. I'm proud of the hard work we did. I get sensitive around like creative issues. I think I still do. And it feels like the process is dear to my heart. And so that was the hardest thing about the group, which is what I felt should be the most gratifying thing about the group. That was the reason why I left. Cause I was like, I can't make art, but anyway, did this thing with Jets to Brazil. Chris Daly named the band Jets to Brazil. It's taken from a poster in the movie Breakfast at Tiffany's, where there's like a travel poster behind her that says Jets to Brazil in a scene.
Wow.
And I think he had watched the movie and was like, hey, what do you think of this name? And we were like, wow, cool. But yeah, and then we just started. It was like we got home from Europe. Not long after that, we went down to Memphis, Tennessee to record the record. Wait, I'm getting this backwards, actually. We recorded our record in Memphis, and then we got Pete Martin in the band, and then we went on tour because we recorded the record as a... Hold on. Hold the phone. Okay. We went to Europe first. We came home. Pete was let go from the band. That's what happened. Blake called. I remember he called Chris and I and had said like, hey, I think this is what's going to be best for the band. And we were sort of like, okay, we'll trust your vision going forward. And then we went to Memphis and recorded the record as a 3-piece down at Easley Studios, which is where the White Stripes and the Breeders and Wilco had recorded down in this cool studio. It has since burned down, which is unfortunate.
Tragically, yeah.
Yeah, it was this beautiful studio, and we had just like this, the experience was fantastic. God, we just started playing shows and going on tour.
I was jamming Crown of the Valley earlier, really listening to Jets to Brazil, specifically looking for you in the music. And I found myself playing the air bass, trying to mimic your bass lines. Because, man, there's some terrific grooves in those songs.
Well, that's really nice. I'm a fan of like classic rock and lots of pop music and stuff like that. Melodic bass playing. I thought, I don't just want to hold down the root the whole time. I would really like to add some melody to this situation. And I love, you know, Paul McCartney and John Entwistle and all these bass players who are like fantastic. And then Eddie from Handsome was just this like crushing bass player. Just, he was ridiculous. Tony Bono, who was in the band Into Another, who I had toured with from New York, he was like this dude. He was in the band Whiplash. They were like an 80s metal band. I have never seen a bass player like him. They would rehearse before shows, just he and the drummer of the band, and he would be playing these parts. And it was like his part was the whole song. I was like, oh my God. I had never seen anyone play bass like that. Melodic lines, holding it down, incredible sense of rhythm, in the pocket, whole package. Funny dude from New Jersey, long hair, just like, hey, dude, what's up? You know, like that kind of guy. And oh my God. He has since passed away tragically, but I tried to soak in his energy and like spit it back out in some way. Andy Rourke from the Smiths is like a really, really good bass player too. So
yeah, I hear all of that.
I had lots of bass idols, but it was really fun to do. And yeah, that situation took off. I really like, we weren't sure what was going to happen. And we just started, the record came out and we went on tour immediately and the shows got larger and larger. And we worked our asses off and rehearsed a lot and wrote a lot of songs and did the band for like 7 years.
Now I know Blake is back doing some Jawbreaker shows now.
Yeah.
Any chance of a Jets to Brazil show maybe?
I don't know. I wouldn't say that that's never going to happen. I bugged my bandmates around the 20th anniversary of Orange Rhyming. I was like, hey, if anybody's feeling it, my kids are old enough where I can like leave my house now.
funny how that enables us to get out and start making music again.
I think Jawbreaker had just decided to get back together. And you know, that was like everybody was waiting for that. Yeah. Yeah. And so it was the biggest thing since sliced bread. So, I mean, kudos to those guys. They're doing it. And I'm not holding my breath about the Jets to Brazil thing. It would be fun, but it doesn't hurt my feelings.
Come ride the little train that is rolling down the tracks to the junction. Forget about your cares. It is time to relax at the junction. Lots of curves, you bet. And even more when you get to the junction.
The diversity of your taste extend enough that it makes some sense, but I think it might be a little jarring to get from Handsome to Cub Country. Yeah. where you lean into some of that alt country style with a more of an acoustic guitar vibe.
I think I've always been a fan of like songs. When we were younger and we played in hardcore bands, you know, a lot of the people, and even like just growing up, being in the culture of playing in bands, a lot of people will, they quit their band and then they're like done with music, which always just like melted my brain. I was like, you sold all your gear? Why would you do that? Music still exists, you know, outside of your band. And I was always a fan of like someone who could pick up a guitar and play a song and sing lyrics that were captivating and the song was good and they didn't need anything else. That became like the mark that I was looking for. When I got all that heaviness out of my blood, I was like, I want to be able to like pick up a guitar and sing songs and just like sit on a street corner and sing songs. That sounds great. And Blake was a real big inspiration. You know, I had cut my teeth with people like Peter Mengede, who was like, he looked at music like I'm working for this. I'm writing songs, I'm following through. Cause there are so many people in music who are like, they say yes. And then you realize that like, oh, they can't actually do this. They don't do this. And then there's people like Peter who I was like, Jesus, he just keeps writing songs. You know what I mean? And they're done. They're finished songs. And then Blake, he just keeps writing songs. And I was like, I remember I tried my hand at writing a Jets to Brazil song, and bless Blake, he was like, yeah, do it. And so I wrote a song and I was like, I'll sing this song, you know, it'll be like the Jeremy song on the record. And we rehearsed it and I wrote a song and we rehearsed it. And then I was like, this song sucks. And this is going to be the song on the record that people are like, that record's good, but I always skip that one that the bass player sings, you know. I didn't want it to be that song. So I went off and did my own thing. I pulled all the Jets guys in for a while. They were my band for a little bit because they were super gracious and none of us had jobs at the time. So
when you can't tell the difference between light and dark, and your mind is stoned and cold like wind through the park, in all your foggy midnights, trying to burn the world down with a spark.
I wanted to make a record that was reflective of the stuff I was listening to and that I had grown up on also. And I wanted to pull in all these like interesting personalities. Like I got Theo from the Lunatics to sing on my first record. Chris Traynor, my good buddy, who I played in Helmet with, who plays in Bush. He plays on all the Cub Country records. And actually for a moment I had Paige Hamilton locked in to do some guitar on one of the Cub Country records.
Wow.
And then I just couldn't. I was like, I can't find the time where you're doing nothing and I'm doing nothing. It wasn't. But I was trying to get all these sort of folks I knew, and I had just gotten Pro Tools and I was getting pretty good at it. And so I was sending CDs to people in the mail. It was before file sharing like Dropbox and things like that. And that gave me the itch to produce music, which is like, and then I recorded all those Cub Country records except for the last one. They were all recorded at my house in whatever locale I was living in. So in New York and then in North Carolina and in Seattle and in Salt Lake. And yeah, that was really fun and taught me a lot.
It's an incredible career to go from Iceburn all the way to Cub Country and all points in between.
What I like about your career, sort of, there's a maturation to it. You know, you start as the punk kid, you know, into the hard rock. It sort of softens, you know, and now you find yourself with Cub Country, and we're older now. We're not as angry as we once were. We're not,
yeah,
you know.
Speak for yourself, Piggins.
fair point. I'm not as angry as I was in my 20s.
Still,
you know?
Pissed off.
I'm still super pissed.
I mean, there's plenty to be pissed off about right now, actually, but
sure.
I had to, at some point, coming out of like hardcore and hard rock and all that, I sort of, people drop off because they're not really interested in music. They're more interested in being in a band, where I think that I was always interested in music and pursuing that. And I wanted to, I can't get enough. I have this singular passion for like doing the thing. So I work on music all the time.
What do you listen to in your spare time, Jeremy? What are you like drawing inspiration from?
That's a good question. In the mornings, I like to listen to Fleetwood Mac.
Nice. Which era? The blues era or the pop era?
I listen to the pop era actually, but there's a few songs from the blues era I like. But my tastes are all over the place. Like the other day I was listening to MF Doom on Spotify, and my kid was like, "You like MF Doom?" And I was like, "Dude, go look at my record collection."
We'll close on, you know, what's your ambition for what's next?
Well, I have a company called Timber Music Supply, and I make production music for film and television and advertising. That's what I do. I write songs all the time. So I still work on lots of music. I've got a home studio. That's where I'm sitting right now. And I've got like a musical partner, and he and I we make songs constantly. So we make these records that are like genres of music, and we'll sing on them and play all the instruments and produce them. And that's like what I do now. So I get like little placements here and there in television shows and things like that.
Keith, I think it's interesting as shit. As we go through and talk to people and we seek out people for the show, these people that made music that seems to have endured, they all say a similar story about it was never about a scene. It was never about a t-shirt. It was about songs.
Yeah. I mean, I'm sure we're all obsessed with songs, right? I mean, you know, I've always got like a drum beat to a song going through my head, and people, you know, my wife tries to talk to me and I am completely spaced out because I'm thinking about Lord knows what. I'm thinking about whatever I just heard on Spotify or something, you know, like I'm like, oh yeah, what? Say what you just said again. We didn't get to the helmet years.
We could probably do an entire episode just on the helmet years.
And I put out a kid's book too that was based on one of my songs.
Oh, cool. That's amazing.
Yeah.
Congratulations. That's cool.
Thank you. I didn't put it out. Abrams put it out, but it was based on a song I wrote. And then this woman, Nikki McClure, she illustrated the book, and she's a famous kids book artist.
Wow.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
That's very cool.
It's pretty awesome.
Let's put a to be continued on this. I'm trying to get you back to your family in time to kiss the kids goodnight, you know? Holy shit. Thank you so much, man. This was so fun.
Yes, thank you very much.
I appreciate you reaching out, and I appreciate the opportunity to talk about the record. I'm glad it has like survived all these years, and you know, it's like it means something to me too. Probably because of its challenges. Yeah. It means something. So I think it's like, yeah, it's cool to have like. The record has a cult following. I'm going to say it.
It absolutely does. It absolutely does. And there was something magic about you and the two guitar interplay that was, it was neither Quicksand nor Helmet. It was its own fucking thing.
Yeah.
It does have a cult following, and I'm one of the cult, damn it.
I just joined, so.
Nice. I love that.
Your Kool-Aid is in the mail, Keith.
Love that.
Good, man. Jeremy, thank you. We will schedule episode 2 and do the helmet thing another time.
For sure.
All right.
Take care.
Bye.
Bye.
Many thanks to Jeremy. Be sure to sign up so you can catch part 2 sometime in season 5.
Our theme song is Rocket Sled by Blip. Abandoned Albums was recorded at Thunderlove Studios.
Written and produced by Keith R. Higgins and Jeff Calhoun.
Engineered and mixed by Steve Beasley with the help of Mike Hunt. Edited by AJ Royce.
You heard a lot of songs during this episode. They were Ride Down, Needles, Dim the Lights, Thrown Away, and Swimming All by Jeremy's band, Handsome. You also heard the Jets to Brazil song, Crown of the Valley, and finally Wind Through the Park by Jeremy's current project, Cub Country. You can stream all of these bands wherever you stream your favorite music.
Original music by Mike Pellegrino.
If you like what you've heard, please be sure to subscribe and leave us a rating. It really does help. Thanks for listening.
At Twitter, we are at Abandon Albums. And on Instagram, we are at Abandon_albums.
Grazie.
Daily Leaf. Rob Janicki. Mike Pellegrino. Therina Vella. Ronnie Barnett. S.W. Loudon. Michael Janicki. Peyton Janicki. And our executive producer.
This is Thunderwolf.
And now, until we meet again next time, I remain as always obediently yours.
Abandoned Albums is a production of Paw Print Media.